splendor of a king, clothed in majesty.
Good afternoon, viewers. This is Real Biblical Talk. And today I have a very important guest with us here, Apostle Fabrice Mbuna. Very great guy. Wonderful man of God. I'm highly impressed to meet this young man at his age doing some wonderful work. Wonderful work. And today I have the honor of sitting with him here to interview him. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Welcome to the show. And I will talk to him. I'll ask him a few questions about him so that he can introduce himself precisely, who he is, and what he's been doing for the past years before now. Over to you.
Well, thank you very much for this opportunity, which you have actually given me to express myself. Before we start, I would like to say good afternoon to all the televiewers and to all the tele-listeners, actually, who are listening to this program. My name is Chinda Fabrice Mbuna. I am an apostle and a traveling evangelist. I'm a writer, I'm a dramatist, I am actually a poet. Of my origins, I am a Cameroonian, born in 1984 in Cameroon, Santa Akum, Northwest Province. And in my early age, I was so much fascinated with the art of speaking and the art of writing. After obtaining my first school leaving certificate and common entrance examination, which is a state examination which each and every one has to take before they can move to the secondary level, yes. I went to the secondary school. So when I went to the secondary school, I was introduced to different field of studies, yes. Because at this particular juncture, it was no longer like the primary school where we were taught about the basics of education and many educational stuff. So I was just being fascinated that in the course of nurturing my dreams in the primary sector, when I got to the secondary sector, I saw a lot of teachers who were well equipped, and they saw my zeal and capacity to be able to, you know, to work with them. And so they placed before me the resources, the academic, intellectual, emotional resources. So I took upon me the challenge that I must actually achieve my dreams by hook or by crook. That is when I got introduced to the first Shakespearean play, Romeo and Juliet. Oh. So upon reading Romeo and Juliet, I was so much fascinated, and I was trying to ask myself the question, what is Mr. William Shakespeare trying to articulate in his novel? So at a higher level, I started studying poetry. I spent a lot of my secondary life doing a lot of acting, a lot of writing. I won a lot of contests as the best orator, poet, dramatist, and so on and so forth. So that gave me a lot of credibility because that introduced me to a lot of local media, a lot of writing, which I did. And, you know, it gave me a stamina which I did not actually believe. In some few years, I had my ordinary level examination, which is still a state examination, which evaluates the people's intellectual level. So even though normally you have to go through 5 years of education before you go in for the state examination, I did 4 years. When I did 4 years, actually, I was very, very much successful. So I had to skip the fifth class and went to the sixth level. And from the sixth level, I went to the seventh level. And from the seventh level, I wrote what they call advanced level. That was the final educational system of my country, Cameroon, in order to get into the university. So when I finally got into the university, I enrolled in the Faculty of Letters and Human Sciences, where English Modern Letters actually became my main field of specialization. So I was challenged with a lot of linguistic theories, a lot of literary theories. I did orature in Africa, literary criticism. And when I got to the third year, that is when we were given the opportunity to specialize. So my specialization, actually my major was literature, and my minor was mass media and communication. And so in this case, when I talk about literature, literature actually has three genres. Literature, we have poetry, we have prose, we have drama. So I had, I was very, very fortunate that I had professors like Professor Enongene Sone, who was my professor of literary criticism, and my professor of poetry and drama, Madame Vivian Komelek, who actually gave me the support at the university level. So that is when I compiled close to 200 poems in the university.
Wow.
So that was my explosion as an artist, as a writer, being known all over the place in the university, and had to mentor people in the art of poetry writing and literary writing. And so my first play, which I acted, which ended me a lot of credibility in the university, was a play written by an English writer called D.H. Lawrence, and precisely Sons and Lovers. So after I acted the play, that is when I was really discovered to have a lot of talents and potentials given to me by the Almighty. So upon my graduation from the university in 2007, I actually worked in the GLONASS Institute of Leadership with my mentor, who is actually a public speaker and also a preacher, Dr. Paul. So he actually helped to nurture most of the gifts and the talents in me, and that really permitted me to excel, because under his tutorship, I actually worked as a conference facilitator, interpreter, since I speak two languages, English and French.
Yes.
So I often translated most of the, let's say, speeches or conferences that were being held either from English to French or French to English.
Amen.
So that actually permitted me to be developed within a short period of time after my graduation when I left the university. So when actually the Lord told me I really needed to go to America where I have to serve him, but the Lord reminded me that I had some books I had to write.
Yes.
So no, upon telling me that I had books to write, so all what I've been doing, you know, from my primary level right up to the university and postgraduate, I never took it to be very serious, even though I just did that with full passion and commitment. But I was keeping the manuscript and compiling all the literary stuff and the inspiration that I had. So finally, when the Lord asked me to go and play the American Lottery, that is the DV, as it is popularly known.
Yes.
So I went and played the DV, and actually I won the DV.
It's
and
God.
I got, I came into America, that was March, the 3rd of March 2010. So when I came to America, I was so fascinated in Africa, because I often than not we hear about America. So when we hear about America, I thought maybe America was just like a village there we have there, you know. I never knew that was another world of its own.
Yes.
So when I got to America, everything was just strange. Yeah. I never knew I was here on earth. So coming to be challenged with a lot of culture and with a lot of philosophy and with a lot of theology, I realized that I was like growing from stage one to stage two, because I was more in an intellectual world than where I was before.
Yes.
But still giving credibility to those who had nurtured me, because my gifts at this particular juncture were already developed,
yes,
whether spiritually, whether talents, intellectual, everything was already developed.
Yeah, amen.
So being in Maryland, finally I decided to go to New York to continue with my master's program.
Amen.
Where actually I did theology.
Amen.
Is when I got to New York and I was in the presence of God at the books that God had promised so many years ago.
Yes.
I was going to write for his people, that he started bringing and giving me the books to write.
Amen.
It was somehow very, very fascinating, because you can't imagine that with the volumes of books I wrote, I'm an author of 12 books.
12 books?
12 books.
Mm.
And I wrote 8 books within the space of 1 year with 3 publications.
Amen.
I mean, 8 books within the space of 1 year with 3 publications. Man. When I'm talking about books, I'm not talking about leaflets. Each of my books at least has 100, the least is 150 or 200 pages.
Amen.
Running close to 500 pages of the books that I had to write.
Amen.
Amongst which, The Evil Behind the Law, Volume 1, Volume 2, Volume 3, Volume 4, were the first collections I wrote. On my wedding day, coupling with other books to veil on HIV and AIDS, which is like a challenge to the world of science, theology, history, about the evolution of HIV and AIDS in our society.
Amen.
Just like Charles Darwin came out with his theory to prove to the whole world that man actually evolved from monkey. So this is just like the third version of it, which is like to refute some of this theology or ideology and show how all this theology and ideology can be fused in one to create a world of unity.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. I'm getting excited already. Look at this. You know? Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful man of God. Now, let me quickly ask you a few questions here.
Yes, please.
You know, I'm seeing a lot of books here. You have the first one here is The Evil Behind the Law, Volume 1.
Exactly.
Then number 2, The Evil Behind the Law, Volume 2.
Volume 2.
And a half year on my wedding day. So God has really endowed you with a lot of gifts, you know. And let me ask you a couple of questions before we go into the books. Now, what after you read literature?
Yes.
In a college, and then you decide to go into theology. And then what really make you now leave the world of literature and get into theology? I like to know that, because it looks like you have a plan. And, you know, give me a little bit of it.
Well, I think, first of all, if you have to talk about any form of theology, we have to understand the meaning of theology.
Yes.
According to my understanding of theology, theo simply means God, and logi means study. So theology simply means the study of God. And God is everything.
Amen.
Omnipotence, omniscience, God is literature,
Amen.
God is philosophy,
Amen.
God is poetry,
Amen.
God is drama. In other words, I believe that theology, which is the study of the master himself, which is God,
yes.
is just like the main icon, and things like literature, poetry, philosophy, archaeology are just sub-icons or sub-titles within the major. They are just minor. So by me trying to study theology is, first of all, to understand the evolution of literature, anthropology, sociology, and all forms of logies.
Amen. Amen. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Now you are viewing Real Biblical Talk. And I'm now interviewing Apostle Mbuna Fabrics. Now, very wonderful man of God. Now, you know, you love the Lord. From some of the things I've read, some of your books, I have invited you in Facebook, and we've been dialoguing for quite some time. And you really impress me with your love for God. Tell me a little bit about, you know, your relationship with the Lord, because from there, then we can form a platform here. This discussion. Yes.
Well, you know, when you decide to take side with the kingdom of light,
yes.
the kingdom of darkness will not always comprehend, and they will always try to circumvent you.
Amen.
One thing the Bible says about Jesus being the light of the world is the light was shining into the world,
yes.
and darkness did not comprehend. Amen. Darkness tried to prevail, but did not prevail. Well, it's going to be so shocking that even as a man of God, it was not after realizing that I was a man of God, but I was a man of God from the onset, from the creation of the world.
Yes.
Meaning that what I was writing them, whilst an unbeliever. The fact that I never knew God did not stop God from starting his providential work in my life.
Yes.
Or giving me the information that was needed for his providential work.
Amen.
I received most of the literature in secondary school when I was not yet a Christian.
Yes.
I was not yet born again.
Yes.
And so it was in my third year university in 2000, that was August 25th, 2006, I beg your pardon, that I actually got converted in the university.
Amen.
My conversion was just a miracle, just like St. Paul's conversion on his way to Damascus. That is how my conversion actually almost appeared. People didn't understand what happened to me. They knew me what happened to the famous writer and poet, dramatist we know on campus. Has he been brainwashed by all this stuff of being born again? But they never understood that at that particular moment, I came face to face with God, wrestling like Jacob. And God simply wanted to turn my attention to him so that he could give me more material to write.
Amen.
Because the Bible says, he that comes from above is above everything.
Yes.
Inspiration is from above,
yes,
and not from abroad. Since I was receiving the information without actually knowing the source, God just needed to channel my thoughts, my emotions, my desire towards him so that he will filter my thoughts, my emotions, and desire so that Satan would not take advantage and pervert the literature or the arts which I have to bring to his people. So that is when I became conscious of my calling and the grace of God as a scribe.
Amen.
Writing.
Amen.
Even though during that period there was a breakdown of my literary activity and acting because I needed to establish a foundation of faith in my life, which was going to propel me to the next level, many people never understood. They thought because of religion or because of church, I had given up my works, but God simply was working out his foundation. But in due time, he was going to establish everything.
Amen. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Now, let's come to the real issue here. You know, he has written a lot of books. Among them here, we have The Evil Behind the Law, Volume 1. So I was reading through this, you know, man of God, and what I saw in here is fascinating, really fascinating. You know, you have, how many characters you have in this book here? You have, tell me about this book. How many characters you have? I read it, but
the Evil Behind the Law.
Yes.
Well, actually, I think if you have to talk about the book itself, what is very, very important,
yes,
is for us to start with the title itself.
Good. Let's start with the title, The Evil Behind the Law. Wow.
So, we have to understand that the history of humanity following the fall of Adam and Eve has been a history of providence. And when I talk of history of providence, the struggle between light and darkness. And, you know, in the course of trying to restore God, in the course of restoring man,
yes,
back to his creator, there had been several dispensations that God had carried on in history. And one of the dispensations we know about the Mosaic laws. In other words, the law itself that came to direct us to the Master, to Christ,
yes,
to the perfect providential plan of God through grace, was instead bringing us condemnation.
Yes.
That's why when we read the Bible, especially the Pauline epistles, there's a lot of refutation as far as the law is concerned when pertaining to our salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Because the law itself was just a schoolmaster, a pedagogue that was leading us to the perfection of the kingdom in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
But since we do not understand this issue of the law and the work of providence, Satan took advantage of the fallen nature in order to afflict, in order to pass his evil desires in us.
Yes.
And for that reason, when I came to America, America being a matriarchal society, I started seeing a lot of changes which was not like the patriarchal society of my country, Cameroon, or Africa. And so being led by the Spirit of God, I went to one of St. Paul's epistles written to the Corinthians. That is 1 Corinthians chapter 15 from verse 55 to verse 56, which says, "The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law." In other words, We have the law, we have sin, and we have the human weaknesses, which Satan takes advantage in order to afflict and to destroy the providential plan of God. So that is actually where the inspiration came from. I wish I had to take that to write. What do you understand by the law? We shouldn't be confined to defining the law just on basis of the Mosaic law, because the law, we have spiritual laws, we have natural laws, we have parliamentary laws. But since we still have the corrupt nature of the fall of Adam, of the garden of Eden in us, Satan has been using it and using the law in order to suppress and to oppress the society. And that is why I titled the book, The Evil Behind the Law. We must be conscious about the works of Satan passing through the law.
Yes.
Whether parliamentary law, mm-hmm. whether the Mosaic law, or even the prophecy that they give in church. That is a form of the law, which Satan disguises himself as an angel of light to make everything look bright in order to keep us in captivity and to control the world as a historical God.
Amen. Amen. What a beautiful book. You know, as I was reading through it, you titled it, the title is wonderful, but the characters I saw in this book, one of them was Mr. Fabrice and Miss Angel.
Angel.
And then the other one is Miss Asunder.
Asunder.
Oh, my God. Tell us what you're trying to portray with those names.
Well, first of all, we have to understand that the book itself is all about the providence of God, which is a battle between light and darkness.
Yes.
And the Bible itself tells us that what God has put together, let no one put asunder.
Amen.
That is where the name of the main antagonist of the play actually originates, Miss Asunder, which is a fictional character, which means division.
Yes.
Because throughout the play or throughout the novel or the movie, she is always fighting in order to bring division.
Yes.
Now, on the one hand, Fabrice is my name. Yes. I am a dramatist. Yes. I am an actor personally.
Yes.
So, Angel itself. Yes, Angel itself is a character, is an African lady. She's a Cameroonian like myself.
Yes.
Miss Asunder is just an American, an American citizen.
Yes.
She has a paper and she has everything it takes in order to be an American citizen.
Yes.
But a person like myself, likewise, Angel, Miss Angel, we are just immigrants from Africa.
Yes.
But when I leave Africa, for example, because I am going to use myself or trying to use what they call the first person point of view or the first angle narrative, because I am the main protagonist there, Fabrice, because he centers around my life.
Yes.
I leave Africa, Cameroon, and I come to America, and one of my seniors with whom we were back home picks me up at the JF Kennedy Airport in New York. So we have an adage, we Africans here, that your destiny or your life in America depends on the person who picks you up at the airport, who gives you the basic information of what America is all about, where to start and how to end. But upon coming here, I'm staying with her in the same house, but I don't know, her name is Beatrice, who is one of the character in my play.
Yes.
So Beatrice herself, being a good friend to Miss Asunder, who is an American, has become an African, a Cameroonian, more American than the Americans.
Yes.
In fact, she has become what they call assimilationist. She has assimilated the culture, and the culture has been made flesh in her.
Yes.
While I'm staying with her, I come to discover this sweet lady called Miss Angel. She's Cameroonian like myself, she's black like myself, and there's nothing that is going to stop the law of attraction between the two of us.
Yes.
But now, Miss Asunder comes in because she's American, and she decides that no, she has to undo the relationship because she is in love with me. Yes, she's a beautiful woman. She has all the assets to admire, to desire.
Yes.
But the problem is, she believes that with the feminist movement, In America, or like in any matriarchal society, the women are always right before the law.
Yes.
If she can't get what she wants, then the law will be able to procure or to secure everything she wants to her pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What am I supposed to do in such a dilemma? Now she sees that I am so much adamant, she can't penetrate me. And so she decides, therefore, to pass through Miss Beatrice, with whom I am staying,
yes,
to ignite the pressure on me. And Beatrice, who is there hunting for money in America, like every good American or African in America, yes, decides to put pressure on me to forsake my sweet lover from Africa, from Cameroon, Miss Angel, to get married to Beatrice. There is a lot of tension that goes into the relationship.
Yes.
But I say no, no, no. We must learn how to do justice.
Yes.
If we can't do justice on earth with parliamentary laws, one thing I know, that when we get to heaven, justice will be done even without parliamentary law.
Amen.
I don't hate her because she's America, because America is not the problem, but we are the problem to America.
Yes.
The constitutional structure of America is not the problem, but we are the problem to the constitutional structure of America.
Yes.
I don't hate her as a body. I don't hate her as a person. But I can't love her because of the political, economic, and social structure under which we function.
Yes.
At the end of it, she conspires with Miss Beatrice. I am expelled out of the house. I have nowhere to go. I go and meet my sweetheart. Permit me to use that word.
Yes. Angel.
Miss Angel.
Miss Angel, yeah.
And Miss Angel hasn't got a good job that can sustain the two of us.
Yes.
And so Miss Beatrice sees that I can't accept or succumb to her caprices, decides to write an allegation against Miss Angel for her to be fired from her job. And so I am jobless, she is jobless. How are we going to cope with the bill situation in America? We have no choice. And so she goes to the church to meet her pastor to explain the situation. There, the pastor gives her a job as a secretary. But she swears that I can't speak like Judah. While she is a secretary,
yes,
the pastor also gives me a job to handle the theater department of the church.
Yes.
That is when my fame over the media begins to increase every day. So Miss Asunda and Miss Beatrice, they find that we have become committed Christians, and they decide, therefore, to disguise themselves. The devil advocate.
Advocate, yes, yes.
To come into the church, pretending to be brothers, brethren. The Bible warns and tells us, behold, I know those who call themselves the brethren, but they are of the synagogue of the enemy.
Yes.
While he's disguising himself as an angel of light in church, he wants to monitor my activities with angel. Now the wedding has been planned. I am engaged with her, and all her attempts to break the wedding has failed. And so, since she cannot come directly, since she has made herself an apologist,
yes,
a pacifist, a good Christian, she uses money to corrupt Christians in church to come and tell me, you know, the wedding you're about to get married is not from God. I slept and I had a dream. God spoke to me. You need to break that wedding.
Mm.
There is a lot of tension that takes place in there because Satan is also getting into it. She faced at that particular level. And on the eve of the day I have to get married to this lady, Miss Angel, she invites me in her house, Miss Asunda.
Okay, wait there for a little bit. I want to ask you a few questions.
Yes,
it looks like you went deep right inside this plate to actually bring out what is happening in the churches.
Exactly.
Ooh, God Almighty. What I see here, I see that you actually went so deep in the inside the church. Sometimes you see people who are they believe, they're believers.
Angels.
But yes, they are not. You know, they play the game one against the other.
Exactly.
And that's exactly. I'm sure that's why you named that lady Asunder.
Asunder. Everywhere she goes, there
she
is division.
Division was always there. And that's very much in the churches right now, audience. There's so much. Sometimes you wonder. You know, you get inside the church, people, you see some root of unnecessary jealousy that is coming out that you cannot relate to.
Exactly.
You cannot relate to them. You know, you try to study where they're coming from, where they're going, you cannot relate to them.
You can't really.
So the thing is that is what our writer here is trying to bring out of this novel. There's so much inside the church, so much into the faith, so much inside it. So he's talking about a play, The Evil Behind the Law. This is volume one, where you have those character, Angel, Beatrice, Asunder, and Mr. Fabris. So please, let's go on with this interview. Now, you cannot go on. It looks like they now get to where they wanted to wed. There's division. The woman is already in crazy commotion that you touched her, harassment, and that now they took it to court. The same day of your wedding now become the same day that the court setting was set for the event. So now they fix the same date for the court, the same day for the wedding. So how did you manage that? You know, it gets more interesting as we go along. Tell me what happened after that.
Well, I will say love conquers all everything, and yes. God is love. And with love and faith, everything is possible.
Yes.
On the eve of my wedding day with Miss Angel, Miss Asunder invites me to her house.
Yes.
When I come to her house and she tells me, well, openly and boldly, that since she has not been able to prevail over the previous battles, mm-hmm. in other words, she called them battles.
Yes.
Now we have come to the point where we need to face the final war. So that is when I begin to see that she was the one orchestrating all what I've been going through in my relationship.
Wow. So what you're saying is that you don't even know that.
No, I was very much unconscious.
Right, the whole thing.
I was very, very much unconscious about what was happening, but we knew that there was somebody behind, but we never knew who was the villain.
Yes.
And so, well, since we've been at the final stage of it and I'm getting married the next day, she needs to break the wedding at all costs. She tells me, look, this is America. Here, we live in a so happy society. If you have to live in a society or such a society, you must play the game. Mm. You use the judicial system to make money. You use sexuality to make money.
Mm.
Or you use money to make money. There is no option, Mr. Poet. We are not talking poetry here. We are talking the reality of this current society. Mm. She tells me, she gives me the option, if either I have a sexual relationship with her, for her to be pregnant, and she will use that, you know, to get access into my bank account, or expecting child support from me, or she calls the police against me for attempted rape.
Hmm.
I am caught in the dilemma. What do I do?
Now, let me ask you another question here. Right here, what was her reason of inviting you to the house?
Well, her main reason of inviting me to her house actually was a way of, you know, since she has not been able to have me fall into any of her temptations,
yes.
that was the last temptation
yes.
in which she wanted to break me down, to break my wedding,
yes.
to break Miss Beatrice,
yes.
Miss Angel, I beg your pardon.
Mm.
Because at that particular moment, being caught in the same situation, what was I going to do? I'm face to face with her. She has given me that option. It just became like the issue of Joseph in the Bible and Potiphar's wife.
Yes.
Because had I had a sexual relationship with her, for her to be pregnant, then she will use the pregnancy as a means to control my bank account.
Yes.
And so I will never have a peaceful relationship with Angel, even if I don't get married to her.
Yes.
Secondly, even if at that particular moment she called the cops against me, then it takes me to court. She believes that women are always right before the law, so she will have every evidence of rape because they will see it live. So in the course of trying to seduce me, for me to get with her, for her to have tangible evidence before the law, I decide to go to the restroom where I set my tape recorder to record the conversation. By the moment I get to the restroom to set my phone on the tape recorder, upon coming back to the sitting room, she's stripped already, almost naked. Oh my God. At that particular moment, the battle continues. She says, I have no other option. At this particular stage, either she calls the cops or then she breaks the marriage at all costs. I am outspoken and I tell her, I believe you can't undo what God has put together. What God has put together, let no one pull asunder.
That comes to another point in this whole thing here. I think the act also portrayed the marriage home. What the Bible, what the law say about marriages.
Exactly.
That I put together. For this reason, a man and a woman should leave their father and mother, and they should come together to become one. The
one
scripture
flesh.
Say, one flesh. And that I've put together, let no man put asunder. So what is happening is that the lady asunder, Mr. Asunder, was meant to put an asunder.
To put asunder.
And she's done everything in the book to put an asunder, but God has been prevailing with you so far.
Exactly.
And then what happened after that?
Well, after I withstood my ground, or after withstanding my ground for so long, and she sees that she can't get me, for my love for Miss Angel is stronger than compromise. Mm-hmm. She slaps me, wanting me to retaliate or to slap her for her to use even the physical abuse as a means of filing her lawsuit. But I don't retaliate. I let her do whatever thing she could, brutality, shouting, and everything. But one thing I knew that my phone was actually recording the conversation without her knowing. And so in the final analysis, she begins to scream, tearing into pieces her dresses as if she was being forced in an action of rape. So in the course of screaming, the neighbors hear the noise and they don't know what is happening. They call the cops. In a few minutes' time, the police surround the building and everything. And so she presents me to the cops as being a rapist. But since my wedding was already planned to take place the following day, and God's plan cannot be changed, darkness can never overcome light, they decide to put my trial on the day I'm supposed to get married. I come to church. My wife, to-be, Miss Angel, comes dressed as if she's going for a wedding, her veil, her gloves, and everything. With me, I have two rings written, Unbreakable Bond of Eternity.
Unbreakable bond of eternity. Look at that. Unbreakable. So that means that you and Angel are unbreakable.
Unbreakable.
Amen. Amen.
The covenant
Amen.
Of God cannot
the covenant
be broken.
Of God cannot be broken. Yes. That's how people should view marriage. Marriage is not just a thing that you walk in and walk out. Marriages come with packages. And the packages it comes with, we are supposed to endure those packages and work with those packages. You know, I had a discussion once somewhere where I brought an issue out about a family that was counseling that have a serious problem with one problem or the other. And one of them wanted to hop out of the relationship. You know, I told him, I said, a relationship is meant to stay forever. Because the Bible says that I've put together, let
no one
put
asunder.
And the thing is that we cannot get out of a relationship that because of trouble or problem, obstacles. They are meant to build us, not to break us. Amen. So we're talking about the book again, The Evil Behind the Law, Volume 1.
Volume 1.
Like, I mean, this book is interesting. I mean, it's an interesting book. Go ahead.
So fascinating, when I get to court with her, the pastor comes into since we have been committed member of the church. Yes. They're so surprised that such a thing could happen amongst brethren. And instead of taking it before the council of elders to be judged, but it's been taken to court. Hmm. So the pastor is there, the choir is there, and everybody is there waiting to see what is going to happen. It's just like the battle of Armageddon, where they are actually seeing who is going to prevail, Jesus or Satan.
Oh, yes.
So
yes.
There is a toss that is taking place. So when I'm called upon to, if I actually have any objection concerning the accusation of rape being levied against me, I say, well, there's nothing like that. Everything is a frame story. And they ask me, do you have any proof? The only proof is my conscience, myself, and the tape which I have in my pocket. Yes. I pull out the tape before the court. So I play the tape to the hearing of each and every one. But at a particular moment, if justice is to be done, let justice be done. Even if I have to go to prison innocently, as so many people do, it shouldn't be for the cause of a crime committed, but it should be for the sake of the woman which I love.
Now, let me just ask you a question. So Beatrice was going to the same church with you afterwards.
We were all going to the same
church.
Now,
the pastor who is there to wed you have an idea that he is a member of a church who have just given a bad name and taking a member, a co-member, to court instead of taking the problem she have to church.
Exactly.
To be looked into by the pastor. So the right there again, that's another asunder.
Another asunder. Everywhere she goes, there is asunder.
That's another asunder. And because Paul warned about that very well. He talked about it. And he said that when any one of us have any trouble within the church, it should be settled within the church.
Exactly.
It should not be taken to unbelievers to judge us.
Exactly.
You know, because we're saints, we're supposed to be judging the angels.
The angels.
Yes. Amen. Amen. I just want to bring that up. Again, we're talking about the evil behind the law. This is real biblical talk presented by Kingdom Based Ministry. Okay, go ahead.
Well, after presenting my facts before the court and the juries and the president and all those who were in the hall, and listening to the story pathetically from the tape, they saw that everything was was frame up, it was a setup. It was not actually what the version of accusation which was given by Miss Asunda. And for that reason, the judge who was supposed to condemn or to sentence me for imprisonment against rape, yes, decides therefore to approve of my marriage,
amen,
with Miss Angel before the court, the pastors, and I mean the church, the brethren in church. So the scenario in the last minute turns for the glory of God. And the same Asunda who throughout my acquaintance had wanted to put division in the relationship,
yes,
to get me for herself, sees me getting married in front of her.
That must be in the book of Esther somewhere, where they dug a hole for Mordecai, and the Jews, especially Mordecai, you know, they wanted to throw him right inside that gallows.
Exactly.
Now, right at the last minute, what happened? God turned everything around.
He turned everything for his glory.
For his glory.
Everything
now,
was...
The man, what is his name again, Mr.... The man, Haman now went straight inside the gallows.
The gallows.
So right here and there, the woman Asunda now went into the gallows. She dug for you.
Exactly.
Amen.
Exactly.
God is awesome. You see, it's good to be good. Good to be good. You know, we need to walk righteously. You know, and the woman was not, and she had the fruit of unrighteous behavior.
But one thing so fascinating about this book is because I try to bring contrast between the judicial system trying to establish a perfect plan for the kingdom of God and also the churches. Because when you look at most of our seminaries today, they have what they call the theology of intercultural marriages, which I am like trying to criticize and to bring out the weaknesses of this theology. I said we can't be talking about trying to use the theology of intercultural marriages in order to establish a providential foundation to break racial barriers in America where God is going to establish his kingdom. I say the idea is good, but we know that we are working in a society where the political system or the political laws are not in line with most of the principles of the kingdom. In other words, the major one of the primary importance of marriage for God, or what he values more, is happiness. So I see no reason why I should decide because of theology and leave, maybe get myself entangled into any marriage or relationship which is not going to give me happiness, or is going to give God happiness. If we have to talk about theology of intercultural marriages, for the breaking down of racial barriers and the establishment of a providential foundation for God to act, what we have to consider also is the political situation. Mm-hmm. If the political laws are not in line with the principles of the kingdom, then chaos is going to be.
Amen. Amen. Wow, look at that. That's awesome. Okay. Well, we're getting there. We're getting close. We're gonna be rounding up a little bit. Now, you talk about this, the evil behind the law. Now, you have volume one, volume two, and volume, how many volumes?
Actually, it's a series of four volumes.
Four volumes, but right now
two publications
are out. So, please, now, could you tell everybody where your website would be and if they want to check this out?
Well, for my professional website, you can go to www.fabricembuna.com.
Good.
Fabrice, I spell Fabrice because I know there is a Fabrice in America, which yes. means air fresher, but yes. that is not what I'm talking about.
Okay, spell it so that I can hear it. Spell it all out.
The Fabrice I'm talking about is F as in Francis, mm-hmm. A as in Apple, B as in Bert, mm-hmm. R as in Robert, mm-hmm. I as in Indian, C as in cat, E as in elephant.
Good.
Mbuna, M as in man, B as in bird, U as in union, N as in Nancy, A as in America.com.
.com. Good. Awesome. Awesome. Beautiful. So if you want to get a copy of these books, you should please go to that website. And if you also get in touch with me, kingdombasedministry.org, I can also look into that for you, to get these books for you.
And another way, one of the easiest way even to have the books is you just need to go to the Google search engine,
yeah.
and you type The Evil Behind the Law, Volume 1,
Good.
Or Volume 2. Good. All the books are going to pop up.
Awesome, awesome. Now, you have another book here. We're going to be winding up in a few minutes because our time is almost over. On My Wedding Day. Wow. It does give you a little, it's not going to be too long because we're almost running up. This is going to be the conclusion of the interview today.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
I believe so much in the unity of marriage because even every nation, marriage to me symbolizes the relationship between the head of state and the nation itself. So in this book, On My Wedding Day, it talks about the providential work of God from the point of creation, from the fall, the different dispensation, and the rapture, or when we go to meet with the Lord.
Yes.
So that is basically what My Wedding Day is talking about. But it is worth noting that, it's worth to note that all the books are dramas. They are play. They can easily be adapted into movie or series. They are not like prose, which you have to strain yourself to read.
Yes.
No, they are simple. And the technique I had to use in writing these books is a melange of two literary genres, that is poetry and drama. So the books are very, very entertaining.
They are entertaining. They are absolutely entertaining. Going through these books, you will love them. You know, you will love this book. You know, you're doing an awesome job in the kingdom. You know, because the Lord, what the Lord requires of us is teaching. And I like the way you come across to the public, you know, to the society. You know, you use the poetry and the, how do you call it, the drama part. The
drama, of
it.
Drama.
Come inside. You know, people love dramas. they love stories. You know, they want something they can identify with, something they can understand.
No,
you got to come to their level and be able to explain it to them. They can understand it. Something entertaining. So these books are really entertaining, and I urge you, please, go and get a copy, and you will love it. It's awesome, awesome, awesome book. You know, again, thank you so much for this show. Thank you for coming. And I see a talent out of you, and I pray that God will
begin to do miraculous things in your life,
open doors for you,
and you know, use it to touch lives of people.
Amen.
You know, society's now, they need to read books like this so that they can know what the plan of God is for us.
Amen.
The plan of God is for us. Society need the more society know about Christ, the better it will be for us.
Amen.
We live in a decent environment, and the urges to commit crime will be cut out completely.
Exactly.
And then the perfect kingdom we're looking for, that can't be on earth.
Be established.
You see, let that will be done on earth as it is
in heaven.
In heaven, you know. So our God is good and it's awesome. I want to thank you again for coming. And we really, really appreciate you. I'm sure that the audience enjoy you today. And they will be calling. You can call me up at 202-471-0026. At any time, again, 202-471-0026. Evangelist Jessy, the host of Real Biblical Talks. Thank you very much. Good night.
Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.